Boarding stopped.
आरटीटीसी नागपुर, आर यू गेटिंग माई वॉइस? आरटीटीसी नागपुर,
आ रही है सर, आ रही है।
प्लीज मेंशन योर नेम, प्लीज मेंशन योर नेम इन द पार्टिसिपेंट लिस्ट सो दैट वी कैन आइडेंटिफाई सर।
सर आई एम संजीव तोमर, डीजीएम सोलन, हिमाचल
सर ये
प्रदेश।
मेंशन कर दीजिए सर, इसमें एक्चुअली जो है ना हम लोगों को प्रॉब्लम आती है, कल मुझे भी प्रॉब्लम आ रही थी इंटरेक्ट करने में ना, कि
ठीक
नाम देने में दिक्कत आती है, इसमें लिखा हुआ नहीं आता ना, इसमें
ठीक
मेंशन कर दीजिए जब आप ज्वाइन करते हैं तो उसमें ऑप्शन आता है।
तो लीव करके दोबारा करना पड़ेगा फिर सर, है ना?
हाँ लीव करके दोबारा कर लीजिए, कोई दिक्कत नहीं है।
हेलो
So, good afternoon to all of you. Are you getting my dear participant? Are you getting my voice properly?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So, I have a privilege to introduce a wonderful personality, a public and a social figure, Sri Ashok Kumar Ji, Director, Wireless Access from NTI PRIT. Sir is the well-known expert in the field of 5G. And other than this, sir is very helpful and always. And basically, मुझे नहीं लगता कभी हमने सर को एनटीआई प्रेट का पार्ट माना हो. सर इज ऑलवेज डेडिकेटेड फॉर बीएसएनएल एंड एएलटीसी. ही जस्ट ए कॉल अवे फ्रॉम अस. सो टुडेज टॉपिक इज 5G कंसेप्ट एंड यूज केसेस फॉर बीएसएनएल. सो विदाउट वेस्टिंग ए बिट ऑफ टाइम, आई एम हैंडिंग ओवर द सेशन टू अशोक कुमार सर. सर काइंडली सर डिलीवर, सर काइंडली ब्लेस अस विद द डिलीवरी सर.
So thank you, Nitin ji. I hope you can hear my voice.
Yes, sir. Fine, sir.
So thank you, Nitin, for introduction, and also I welcome all the participants. I had seen the list, and some of you I already know, and many of you may be knowing. As I had been in BSNL headquarters for 10 years, from 2003 to 2013, and prior to that in the field, BSNL field units. Let me introduce myself again. I am Ashok Kumar, Director Wireless Access at NTI PRIT, in the same campus where we have LTTC, ALTTC. In NTI PRIT related to 5G, in fact, we are running a certification course, that is a third batch of certification course. Two batches we have already completed earlier. In the third batch, we already have 14-15 officials from BSNL, including some of you from ALTTC and from the field units. And that's going on. That's the second week we completed, total 6 week, 36 hours course. In addition, on 5G, we also conduct webinars. Almost every month, one webinar related to 5G. As of now, we are doing sectorial webinar. So last time we did 5G use cases for manufacturing and logistics on last Wednesday. And prior to that, we had done it for power sector. And earlier we had done it for health sector. So sector by sector, we are doing use cases wherein we see 600, 700 participants from different ministry, academia, and all joining that. So in addition, we had also done a workshop in a physical mode for joint secretary and available officers that we will be continuing and expanding it to the state government. So a lot of activity related to 5G. We are also trying to build 5G lab here at this campus. So once that lab is in place, perhaps we'll have a physical training and physical lab activity also. So with that introduction, let me start today's topic. So the time given to me is up to 3:15, so about in one hour. So I'll try to cover the basic concepts and technologies which are behind 5G to make it 5G, what are all various technologies I'll be talking about. So let's start. So before I go into the topic, let me tell you that how 5G adoption is taking place across the globe as of now. So this particular slide I have taken from one of the report released by Qualcomm in the month of March this year. So if you look at this particular report, what it says that as of now, more than 205, more than 205 operators have already launched 5G services on a commercial basis. And in addition, 280 plus operators are in fact trying to roll it out. They are investing into it. So a very large number of operators are in fact rolling out 5G services. And this is an estimate by Qualcomm that this year, in 2022, about 75 crore 5G smartphones will be shipped across the globe. That's a very, very huge number. And they are also saying, it's a very, very important figure, just look at this, that by 2023, total number of 5G connection will reach 1 billion, that is 100 crore. And if you compare the with 4G, whatever time 4G took to reach this 100 crore or 1 billion, the 5G connections are reaching that particular landmark of 100 crore 2 years faster. So that clearly says or shows that the adoption of 5G is much, much faster than even 4G. The other estimate is that between 2020 and 2025, more than 500 crore smartphone will be supplied or shipped across the globe. This is a very, very huge number. And as of now, more than 1275 different types of mobile phone, dongles, and 5G devices are either launched or under development. So this particular slide tells that 5G is today a reality and its adoption is very, very fast. So with this introduction, so these are various topics which I'll try to cover. So let me move. So first of all, we need to understand that for any mobile technology, which organization actually sets the requirement or the vision? So it is ITU, International Telecommunication Union, sets the vision for a technology and also the radio performance requirement. So this they started doing from 3G onwards. All you know that 2G was developed by ITSI, not by any other organizations. So from 3G onwards, ITU started defining requirement of a next mobile technology and the vision and also the radio performance requirements. So for 5G, they came out with the vision in year 2015 itself, and the performance requirement of the new radio, we call it new radio in case of 5G, that they released in 2017. So if you read their document, they talk about three key usage scenario. The first usage scenario they talk about is EMBB, that is enhanced mobile broadband. The second which they talk about is the ultra reliable low latency communication. And third usage scenario which they talk about is massive machine type communications. So here, to avoid confusion, let me explain you that when you have a service, it will use a flavor of EMBB in some quantity, flavor of URLLC in some quantity, and flavor of MMTC in some quantity. For example, let us take one example of self-driven car. So in case of a self-driven car, the URLLC is the main requirement. That reliability has to be very, very stringent. Latency has to be very, very stringent because it's a self-driving car and there is a chance that it may do an accident if this kind of reliable communication is not there. But you also know that the same car is having lot many parts and that would be fitted with sensors. Lot many sensors would be fitted and those information may be going to the manufacturer of that automobile or some O&M of the service. So the MMTC also becomes important to some extent. And that car will also have certain audio video system or cameras, etc. So enhanced mobile broadband, some flavor or some part of it will also be there. So any service, if you think about, will be mixture of these three usage scenarios. So you cannot find a pure EMBB or pure URLLC or pure MMTC, all because even for a normal video streaming, So you definitely require enhanced mobile broadband, a higher speed, but you also require some sort of latency. Otherwise, your if you are doing a gaming, so latency become very, very important. So it will be mixture of the three usage scenario in some or other quantity. Okay, so now what I'll try to do is that for these three key usage scenario, what are the key performance requirement which 5G should offer? And this is as per the ITU document itself, ITU vision document, and the performance requirement which they have released, right? So for EMBB, the parameters are few parameters that they have defined. The first parameter is the peak data rate. Whenever you have doubt, you can either speak or write in chat box. Better you speak. So when we say peak data rate, what we mean is that if the entire resources of a base station is given to a single device, and if it is an ideal condition, then the peak data rate which one should be able to achieve is 20 Gbps in downlink direction and 10 Gbps in uplink direction. So if you look at the figures which was there for 4G, it is in fact 20 times faster than 4G in terms of peak data rate. So that means for 4G, the peak speed defined was 1 Gbps. But please mind, this 1 Gbps in 4G, you can only achieve once you give 100 megahertz of channel bandwidth to an operator. Because the way it works, unless you give 100 megahertz, you may not be able to achieve 1 gigabit per second even in 4G. Similarly, for 5G also, you require a large chunk of frequency band or channel bandwidth. Now, the next important parameter for enhanced mobile broadband is the peak spectral efficiency. So what is peak spectral efficiency? Any of you? Any of the participant, do you like to answer? When we say peak spectral efficiency or spectral efficiency, what is meaning of that?
Bits per hertz.
Bit per hertz, okay. So basically it is the bit per second per hertz of the frequency. So that is your spectral efficiency. So in case of 5G, it is 30 bit per second per hertz. That means in case you have 1 hertz of frequency, you can achieve 30 bit per second in downlink. So let us take one example. Suppose I give 100 megahertz to an operator. So theoretically, how much peak data rate it can achieve using this 30 bit per second per hertz? Can somebody answer? In case we allocate 100 megahertz to an operator and the spectral efficiency is 30 bit per second per hertz, so how much total speed?
Peak speed? 3 Gbps.
Very right, very right. So it is 3 Gbps. Yes. And now in the previous slide, we discussed that 5G can offer us 20 Gbps. So to achieve 20 Gbps, theoretically, how much spectrum do I require? 20 Gbps by 30 Gbps. How much spectrum do I require to achieve theoretically a 20 Gbps of speed in 5G?
600, nearly 600 megahertz.
Level
6 megahertz.
Very right. So 666 megahertz. So what does this mean? This means that in case in India, if you want to really roll out 5G, we need to allocate higher chunk of frequency bands to all the operators. So today, can you guess any operator how much channel bandwidth they have in total, including 2G, 3G, 4G in any of the circle, particularly BSNL, if you're able to tell me? any LSA, how much spectrum do we have in a particular LSA? So all of you are from DSNL and maybe from mobile also. Can you tell me how much spectrum do you have in your LSA?
In 3G, we have 5 megahertz.
Okay, 3G, 5 megahertz. And others, 4G or 2G or spare?
So in the 2G, nearly it is 6 megahertz. 30 carriers into 200 kilohertz.
Yeah. So basically, if you look at, you will not have, I mean, more than 20 megahertz or 30 megahertz in a LSA, right? Total. So even if you deploy all these bands for 5G, actually you will not reap benefit of 5G, because even if you have 30 megahertz into 30, so how much data speed you can get? So you can just see that you'll achieve very, very less data rate. So that means government is required to give BSNL or other operators a large chunk of frequency band to roll out 5G. And if you compare this with, please bear with me, some noise coming because of some construction work nearby going on in LTTC. So it is 3 times better. So that means in
recording in progress,
it was 10 bit per second per hertz in case of 4G. So it is 3 times better compared to 4G. Okay, the next parameter is the user experience data rate. So let me first explain you what is user experience data rate as defined by ITU. Suppose you have BTS here, base station here, and you are covering an area. So if you go to the 90% area, 90% area towards the edge, so whatever data rate you will be able to get at 90% point is called user experience data rate. So that means the minimum data rate which you should get within the coverage or 90% of the coverage is your user experience data rate. I mean, if you come near to the BTS, your data rate will definitely increase, but the minimum onto the edge, you should get a speed which is called user experience data rate. So what is that? It is 100 Mbps for 5G. It is 100 Mbps. That means on even onto the edge, you'll get 100 Mbps. You should get rather 100 Mbps. And this, if you compare with 4G, it is 10 times more. So for 4G, it is defined as 10 Mbps. So it is 10 times better than 4G. Okay, now let's come to the next parameter, which is mobility. So mobility in 5G, it can support 500 kilometers per hour. And this enhancement in mobility was actually done considering the bullet train, which is getting rolled out across the globe. Even in India, we'll have bullet train and it will be almost nearing speed of 500 kilometers per hour, or even more perhaps. If you go to Japan or China, they have a maglev train, which reaches this particular speed. So even in such high speed trains, your 5G mobile should be working. Now, this is a summary of whatever we discussed. Let's move to URLLC, that is ultra reliable low latency communication. So what are the different key performance parameter which will help roll out services which requires URLLC kind of requirements? The first important requirement is latency. Can anybody tell me what is latency?
Time gap between request to the response.
Yeah, right. So suppose I send some data to you. So the time it takes to reach the data to you and you are able to acknowledge me, that is the latency. So in 5G, they have defined specific latency for URLLC services, right? So whenever in 5G, the services like autonomous car or remote surgery will be rolled out. So there, all the techniques which will achieve this particular latency of 1 millisecond will be deployed. So latency is one of the important parameter for 5G, particularly for URLLC kind of applications. And just compare this with our human eyes. So whenever, if you see that or somebody throws across your eyes, it takes about 200 to 300 milliseconds for our eyes to respond. So the response time or latency of our eye is about average 250 milliseconds. And whereas for machines, it will become 1 millisecond. So that clearly shows that in case, for example, if you have a self-driving car, and suppose a human is driving a car and a machine is driving a car, so the chances of collision will be more when human is driving, all because of these latency and other factors. Of course, that there are many other factors for such collision and all, but just for a comparison, that the latency, which is 1 millisecond, is much, much better than the human eye latency. So the use cases, autonomous car, I told you, maybe remote surgery kind of application, or maybe robots, or industry automation kind of applications where URLLC feature of 5G will be utilized. Now the reliability is the next important aspect for URLLC. So reliability is actually looked at in two sense. One is in terms of bit error rate, like all of us know this BER. So in case of URLLC application, so they have defined bit error rate application by application. So if you look at that definition for URLLC, it is 10 to the power minus 6. That means if you transmit 10 lakh bits, I think I have put extra zero, so one less zero, then only one bit of the error is kind of tolerated. That means the correct bit would be 5 nines, right? So so if you calculate in terms of percentage, that for 10 lakh bits, this much bits are correct. So in 100 bit transmit, how much will be? So it will come 99.999969. So that's why we call it 6-9 reliability, right? So kind of a 6-9 reliability will be there in 5G as per the design. So that is one aspect of reliability. Other is the availability. How much? So there should be always signal available to the devices. So there also the availability should be 99.999%. Okay, let me move to the next slide. And mobility interruption has to be 0 millisecond. That means when you move from one base station area to other base station area. So kind of a make before break concept will be there in the 5G, so that there is no interruption while you are moving from one base station to other base station. So this is summary. Now let's go to next scenario, which is MMTC, massive machine type communication. So in case of MMTC, when we say MMTC, basically we are talking about sensor network. So there will be IoT devices. Every object, every machine at home, at office, at road will be connected to a network. So it will be kind of a huge number of sensors or IoT devices connected on 5G network. So to support that, 5G will support 10 lakh devices per square kilometer, which is 10 times better than 4G. 4G was also supporting up to 1 lakh devices per square kilometer. So that's the connection density, which is very, very important, because in a very, very small area, large number of object, machines, devices will have some sensor, and they would be required to be connected, latched on to the network. Now the next parameter is energy efficiency. So my question is, why energy efficiency is a key parameter for MMTC or massive sensor network? Anyone?
Longer battery life.
Very right. Longer battery life. So why we require longer battery life? Because these sensors will be installed in a very, very remote area. For example, if the sensor is to warn you about the natural disaster, so it has to be installed in a very, very remote area where chances of going and charging the battery or replacing the battery will be very, very rare. So that's why we require battery life of 10 years, 15 years. Similarly, many devices or objects will be embedded with these sensors, and it has to work for a lifetime. Suppose you have bought some equipment, it has to be connected on the network all the time. So the battery behind that sensor should last for lifetime of that particular device itself. So considering all these aspects, the design of the 5G network is such that the energy consumption even towards the equipment is optimized. So it is said that it is 100 times more energy efficient compared to 4G. It is 100 times more energy efficient compared to 4G. So that is the kind of energy efficiency which we have. And the third parameter, which is not mentioned here, is very, very critical and important. Can you guess that, any one of you? One I said connection density, other I said energy efficiency in case of a massive mobile type communication. What is the third requirement which is not coming here, which is very, very important for a sensor network? Anyone from you? Anyone from the participants? Whatever comes to your mind, you can speak. Okay.
More number of devices as well as coverage.
Coverage, yes, you are right. You are very, very right. Coverage is very important. Why? As I said, it will be installed in a very, very remote area. So the 5G coverage should reach there. Sensors would also be there in some equipment which is in basement, deep into second floor of basement or third floor of basement. So the coverage is one of the important requirement. Okay, so this is summary. Now, so where all we can use 5G? So as I said that 5G can be used in all sectors of economy, right? All sectors of economy. So for example, public safety. When we talk about public safety, there can be many applications, right? For example, suppose there is an accident which has happened. So you can deploy a drone to take pictures and take the situation and take other decisions. Drone based on 5G. Today also you can have drone, but with 5G it will become very, very reliable, and also connectivity would be smooth. Secondly, I talked about autonomous car, V2X, or vehicle to everything kind of a scenario. So the collision would be less. So that is also one of the important factor of public safety. In case of disaster, if some medical needs are there, so that you can have remote consultation if you have a 5G connectivity. So there can be many, many applications related to public safety. In the agriculture field also, for soil monitoring, for cattle monitoring, for machinery monitoring, for irrigation management, for every aspect of agriculture, you can use 5G. Similarly, for industry 4.0 or smart industry, where each and every component of the factory would be connected, there is a concept of digital replica, wherein digital replica of particular component in the factory would be accessible outside, and any trouble which is happening, suppose some heating is happening, some pressure is high, all those aspects can be figured out and action taken. Similarly, for AR, VR, XR related services, for entertainment, for education, and for official meeting, etc., would be the use case. So that means there is a use case for every sector, be it agriculture, power sector. So I'm not going into detail because that itself is a big subject. So now, as we have covered the three usage scenario and the key, the performance parameter, now let us talk about various aspects of 5G or the technology behind 5G, which actually makes it 5G. So let us talk about spectrum.
Recording stopped. Recording in progress.
Some noise coming, please bear with me. So third floor here, some construction work is going on, so you'll hear. Okay, now it's gone. So can you guess that 5G will support what kind of spectrum? Anyone from you? So as you know, let me further tell you that if you look at 2G, so 2G initially was rolled out on 900 megahertz, that is the lower side of band. Subsequently, even some operators, when they acquired 1800, so they launched on 1800. 3G was primarily launched on perhaps 1800 and then 2100 megahertz. And 4G was launched on 2100, 2300 megahertz. So similarly for 5G, what are the spectrum, expected spectrum on which it can be rolled out? Any guess by anyone?
It is sub 3 gigahertz and also higher than 27 gigahertz. Two bands are there, FR1 and FR2 bands.
Okay.
Low frequency band and higher frequency bands.
You are right. You are very right. So what he's saying that if when you say frequency range 1, basically we are saying that 410 megahertz to 7.25 gigahertz, that is the FR1. And FR2 is your 24 gigahertz to 52 gigahertz. There are bands in between which are specifically decided for 5G. So you are right. So basically, 2G was supporting only low band, 3G was supporting lower part of the mid band, and 4G was supporting only the mid band of the frequency. Whereas if you look at 5G, in fact, it supports the low band, all the frequencies which are less than 1 gigahertz, be it 800 megahertz, 900 megahertz, 700 megahertz, all are supported by 5G. And this this is supported for covering all those IoT cases or rural and remote connectivity. And then the mid band is your from 1 gigahertz to 7 gigahertz. So basically, all those applications which are enhanced mobile broadband or URLLC, that would be using the frequency band which are in the mid band. And then we also use millimeter wave, that is frequencies we talked about, FR2, that is for creating small cell hotspot and having very, very high data rate in that cell. So these are the three. So 5G will support low band, mid band, and also the millimeter wave. And the use cases we just discussed, that the lower frequency will be for umbrella coverage, rural coverage, remote area coverage. Mid band frequency will be for covering city area and trying to give EMBB and URLLC services. And MM wave will be especially for a very, very dense area, stadiums, etc., where very, very high data rate is required. For example, in a stadium when lakhs of people are there, so there will be few numbers of small cell deployed across the stadium so that everyone can enjoy the high speed data onto their devices. So that is the spectrum for 5G. So we were just talking about FR1 and FR2, which I mentioned that FR1 is 450 to 7.125 megahertz. Actually, this 450 has become now 410 megahertz. In release 15, it was this. Release 16, they have introduced some more bands. So there are three new bands. In addition to whatever band 2G, 3G, 4G is using in the FR1 range, the three new bands are introduced, N78, 77, and N79. And in FR2, this particular in this range, four bands are defined wherein the 5G can be launched. So here I have one question for you. You might have read in the newspaper about Air India flight, which was cancelled. Air India flight to US was cancelled because of some issue related to 5G and airport. Can somebody tell me what was the issue? Or have you heard about the news?
Yes, sir. Suna sir.
क्या न्यूज था कुछ बताए?
We heard that there was a cancellation of some flights in the US because of launch of 5G. We have seen somewhere in the new media, sir.
Okay. So if you have not studied, let me just tell you that the aircraft system, no, they have an equipment called altimeter. This altimeter system is used during landing or takeoff, right? So the frequency band which is used in altimeter is between 4.2 gigahertz to 4.4 gigahertz. So this space, just see. So if you see this, in fact, between 4.2 to 4.4 is not being used for 5G. Even in US, still there was a lot of hue and cry and the problem in US. So why, even if this was not being used in 5G, but still there was issue, can somebody guess what could have been the problem? आप बताएं कि ये प्रॉब्लम फिर भी क्यों था? गेस करें।
एडजेसेंट चैनल इंटरफेरेंस माइट बी द पॉसिबिलिटी।
वेरी राइट, इंटरफेरेंस। सो द प्रॉब्लम वाज दैट मेनी ऑफ द एयरक्राफ्ट विल बी हैविंग ओल्डर ओल्डर ट्रांसमीटर एंड रिसीवर ऑफ द अल्टीमीटर एंड दे विल हैव आउट ऑफ बैंड emissions also, right? So they would be not be able to restrict within 4.2 to 4.4 and they will transmit and receive. So there will be a out of band problem. So it will be, so the signal which they will receive from 5G mobile or their signal to 5G, so there will be an interference, and because of interference there may be the problem in landing or takeoff. So that was the issue. So can somebody tell me that what was the solution which was deployed in US? Because the currently, I mean, the 5G is also getting rolled out and aircrafts are also landing and taking off. Any guess that what solution they might have deployed?
Sir, I think the frequency might have changed.
Okay, somebody said frequency might have changed. So in fact, what they have done, that they have created a buffer zone. They have created a buffer zone around the airports as a short-term solution. Short-term solution is that they have created a buffer zone. In that buffer zone, 5G launches will not use these bands. 5G launches there will not use these bands in the buffer zone, so it will not interfere. The long-term solution, what they are trying, that all the aircrafts should replace their transmitter receiver so that there is no interference. So, but this problem is not coming in India. Why? Any guess? We will not be facing this problem in India. Any guess why we'll not be facing that problem in India?
Currently, we are not using those frequency bands. Sir.
Can you speak bit loudly near to your mic?
Currently, we are not using that 4.2 gigahertz band. So,
very right.
So that may be the reason.
Very right. In India, what we have decided that we will auction N78 band. So this is far away from 4.2 or 4.4. So that problem is not expected in India. So, I mean, whatever plan we have for auctioning the spectrum in mid band, it is between 3.3 to 3.8, which is in 78 band. And that's why in India, we will not be having this issue. My next question is that Japan is also using all these bands. These bands, but the problem which was there in the US was not there in Japan. Why? because their aircrafts, they already have very, very good transmitter receiver with a good filters. So their interference will not be there. So they have taken care from the day one in the planning stage itself. So this I explained. I'll just quickly move on. So I receive a lot of query whenever I try to give a session. So everybody ask about what is the radiation impact of 5G onto human or to the birds, etc. So I'll just in one slide, I'll summarize. This particular picture is available in public domain, that there are two kind of radiation. One is the ionizing and other is the non-ionizing. So the radio frequencies, which goes up to say 300 gigahertz, up to 300 gigahertz. So we have radio frequency. Beyond that, it becomes infrared or visible light or ultraviolet. So here onwards. So it's a non-ionizing. In case of a non-ionizing radiation, and of course it has to be in a appropriate dose, appropriate power. So it do not have much impact. So 5G, even up till now, it can go up to 100 gigahertz only. So although up to release 16, it is 52 gigahertz, but we'll actually go up to 100 gigahertz going forward. So as such, it is in a RF zone, which is non-ionizing. So there should not be any problem. The only problem which you face is the heating of your body. When sometime even you talk for a longer time, you feel heating. So that is the only impact. And our body is so tuned that atmospheric heating, it takes care of, right? So it adjusts, body adjusts itself for any variation in the temperature outside. So as such, there will not be any impact even for 5G. So visible light is also a radiation which we are exposed. So we don't see any problem. Even for ionizing one, for example, we use X-ray, right? But if you use this in a controlled way like X-ray, even the benefit which you get using this ionizing radiation is much more compared to the harm which you get. So if you use it in a controlled way, as such, even 5G will not have any radiation impact. Okay, so there is a concept of massive MIMO and beam forming in 5G. So let me ask you a question. So have you heard about dipole antenna? Dipole antenna? Or you might have seen that Yagi antenna for Yagi Uda antenna for Doordarshan. So can somebody tell me that for a dipole antenna or Yagi antenna, for that matter, any antenna, size of the antenna depends on what? Size of antenna. It depends upon which factor?
Lambda.
Lambda. So normally, if you look at dipole antenna, so lambda by 4 one side, lambda by 4 other side, right? Lambda by 4, lambda by 4. So it is basically half lambda. The size of an antenna is half lambda, half of the wavelength. So just imagine, suppose I have a 900 megahertz, right? So can you tell me that what will be the lambda? That is 1 by 900. Can you tell me what will be the lambda? So it will be a larger number. And that's why 2G antenna looks like, so you have a panel like this, this much big antenna we have, which radiates only, there is only one antenna in the big, that panel. But if you go to the 4G, which is on higher side, that is on 2100 megahertz is operating, or 2300. So in the same panel, you are having 7 cross array antenna, array of 7 antennas or 8 antennas or 6 antennas, right? All because your lambda has decreased, so you are able to pack more number of antenna into the same panel, and you are able to form some kind of beam even in 4G. Now just tell me that suppose I have 30 gigahertz, right? So 30 gigahertz means lambda will come how much? It's a millimeter wave. Can somebody tell me that in case of a 30 gigahertz, what will be the size of wavelength? कोई लैम्डा बताए 30 गीगाहर्ट्ज़ अगर हमारी फ्रीक्वेंसी है
स्पीड ऑफ लाइट बाय 30 स्पीड ऑफ लाइट बाय 30 3 इनटू 10 पावर 8 मीटर पर सेकंड बाय 30 गीगा
सो 30 गीगाहर्ट्ज़ इज फ्रीक्वेंसी व्हाट इज द लैम्डा 1 mm कैन आई से 1 mm
यस
सो इफ माय एंटीना साइज इज 1 mm If suppose my antenna size is 1 mm, so just look at this particular panel. So in a small panel like this, I can embed thousands of antenna elements. I can embed thousands of antenna elements in each sector. And now I have a capability to control each antenna element separately. So I have thousands of antenna. And I can feed input signal or stream. And then because I'm able to steer phase and amplitude of each antenna separately, I'll be actually able to form a beam towards a user. I can be able to form a beam because I'm able to control each antenna. I have number one, very large number of antenna element in a panel. And every antenna element I can control, so I can form a beam towards the user. So now the advantage what has become is that now I am not required to use a macro BTS like 4G, which like the coverage is there even if users are not using. So I'll be forming a beam whenever user want to use the data. Other advantage is I can form beam in a 360 degree up, down, or left, right. So in all direction, I'll be able to form beam because I can now change the phase and amplitude in a way that I can form beam in any direction. So advantage is that my spectral efficiency has increased, receive signal to the user will increase because of the beam, and I'm not wasting energy. I am not radiating when there is no data usage onto the network. So that is the advantage. And then I have a capability to steer the beam. So when car is moving, the beam will also move along with the car, right? So that is also a capability which we are getting in 5G. Okay. Now the concept of small cell. So as we are using millimeter wave, as we you know that for higher frequency, the attenuation is very fast. So our coverage would be very, very small, 10 meter, 20 meter, 30 meter. So this kind of antennas, small antenna having thousands of antenna elements will be deployed. This is a picture taken from internet, the 5G antenna. So very large number of dense network of small cell would be required. So let me pause for some time. So this will create a requirement of optical fiber or radio backhaul to each and every small cell. That's a very, very big issue in our country. Even today, we have fiber up to only 30% of the base stations. So that very, very huge work is there to reach out the backhaul, because if you have to offer 20 Gbps from your base station, your backhaul requirement will be very, very huge. So you have to take fiber to the location. So enabling policy related to ROW, related to the location of spectrum for backhaul, would be a key aspect which government has to think of and operator has to ask for. So people are talking about E-band. When I say E-band, basically it is 70 gigahertz to 80 gigahertz. Certain bands are there which are called E-band. And there are equipment now available using which you can get kind of a fiber-like speed on radio. So this is an NEC equipment. If you give 2 gigahertz of the bandwidth in E-band, that is 70 to 80 gigahertz, you can achieve up to 10 Gbps of the speed in the backhaul. So it is almost like a fiber connectivity. Of course, it will vary depending upon the weather condition and all, but the peak data rate which you can achieve in the backhaul is 10 Gbps. So that is also a way that till the fiber is reaching to all the base station, you can use some kind of backhaul using this E-band radio.
Sir, excuse me.
Yeah, please.
The backhaul requirement is, but the coverage will be lower, no, sir? Whether it can be used for backhaul? Because 5G
coverage. Yeah, so basically we are also looking at a small cell which will have coverage of 10 meter, 20 meter, 50 meter only. So this particular radio would be very, very beneficial to connect small cells. And also, I mean, it in line of sight. So normally these are line of sight equipment. So it can go up to few kilometer also. So as such, up to few kilometer in a city environment, you can use, just like you use microwave today to connect base stations. Similarly, E-band radios can also be used.
Maybe Wi-Fi hotspots or backhaul for Wi-Fi back hotspots.
Yeah. So maybe suppose there is a central BTS location, and around that in 1-2 kilometer you have multiple BTS, so you can create a backhaul using that. Backhaul can cover, can
okay, right,
so you can cover initially, and maybe once you are able to take fiber to each and every site, you can remove this. So this can be
recording in progress.
There are no lies.
Can someone confirm if my slides are visible?
Slides are visible and your audio is also good, sir.
Thank you. So I was talking about IAB, that it can also give a backhaul to the next site. Similarly, there is a concept of mobile IAB, wherein the next node is a mobile. So suppose there is a requirement of connectivity somewhere, you can go with this particular mobile vehicle and you get a connectivity. So that is mobile IAB. You can also install in a train, and train will have 5G coverage and it will be backhauling from all the BTSs coming around. Now there is a concept of side link. This is very important for public safety and all in IoT, wherein if this particular device is getting coverage and this one is not getting coverage, it can get connected through this side link. So the devices can create their own network. So this device is connected to this device and this device, and this is connected to the BTS. So this kind of side link working is also possible in 5G. And use cases of such side link are, of course, the V2X, in addition, public safety, IoT, etc. So now there is a concept of network slicing. So as we know that 5G is a kind of cloud native kind of architecture, wherein all the network functions are software can be deployed on any hardware or onto the cloud. So you can create virtual network for each of the services. Here what we are showing that for autonomous car, you have separate slice. For voice, you have separate slice. For smart metering, you have a different slice. And these slices are not dependent upon each other, independent, completely independent. And they will have their own kind of quality of service requirement. For example, for autonomous car, you require URLLC. Most important, for voice, you require some kind of guaranteed bitrate. For smart metering, your requirement is coverage and connection density. So every slice will offer a different kind of quality of service depending upon the service. So that is a concept in 5G. Now in 5G, there is a concept of edge computing. So what they have done, they have segregated user plane and control plane completely. So that means the user data, suppose you have multiple base stations in a city. So your user data is going to the service or internet onto the same city. Your traffic do not require to travel to the core site. And also the applications are very nearby in the same city, so that latency requirement or the local requirement is met. Of course, you have a central connectivity for control purpose. So that is a concept of edge computing in 5G. There is another concept of open RAN. So traditionally, when we had 2G or 3G BTS, it used to be a single box called BBU on your BTS site, where you will lay either waveguide or optical fiber cable. So now this box is proprietary, hardware and software is purpose built, interface between antenna and this is also proprietary. So that was the traditional equipment. Now what has happened, that the interface they have created open. In addition, they have one product BBU, they can broken into three, RRU, DU and CU. And this can be a generic hardware, generic server. Onto that you can deploy software of RRU, distributor unit and control unit. So you can buy DU from one company, CU from other company, RU from some other company, and it will work because of the open interfaces between. So this is the broad or basic concept of open RAN, and this has enabled many Indian companies like Lekha Wireless, VVDN, Sukta, and so many other companies to create our own applications in India, design, develop, and manufacture in India. So that is what has happened as of now. I think somebody has written in chat box. Okay, so I'll answer it. So, okay, let me first proceed. So a typical 5G network will look like this. So what it says that 4G and 5G will coexist for a very, very long time, 5 years, 6 years, 7 years, just like still 2G is coexisting with 3G and 4G. So similarly, 4G will coexist with 5G, all because you cannot replace or millions and billions of devices which are 3G, 2G as of today in the market. So 4G and 5G will be coexisting network as well as devices for a long, long time. And applications on 5G will be on local server, that is edge computing, and also some part of it onto the central server. So 4G will provide a macro coverage. 5G can provide macro coverage with beamforming, or there'll be a small cell on street light and other places for higher data rates. So this is a kind of typical 5G network which will coexist with 4G. So if you look at various forecast, which I talked about in the first slide. So one of the key point which additional here, I want to tell that even in India, the forecast is that by 2027, 40-50% of the connection will become 5G. That clearly means that 4G will also survive for next 5-6 years. So if a company is like BSNL is rolling out 4G today and tomorrow they'll upgrade to 5G, it's not a bad decision, it's a right decision. Okay, so let me tell you quickly, I have 5 minutes left, that there is a lot many talk about India 5GI technology. So what is that India 5GI technology? Can somebody tell me if you know it? Jo India ne 5GI banaya hai, wo kya hai? Can somebody tell me?
Yeah.
Any guess, any answer? Okay, let me tell you that what India has done is that on the top of 3GPP release 15, they have taken that specification and they have changed a very, very little thing in the modulation. And that change was done for large coverage but low mobility. I talked about mobility of 500 km per hour. But in India, for rural, mobility may not be a key aspect. So if I can have a large coverage with a lesser data rate, that is more beneficial to me. So what India did is like we introduced pi by 2 BPSK modulation. So with this, I was able to cover a larger distance. So on top of 3GPP 5G specification of release 15, TSDSI of India introduce this pi by 2 BPSK modulation for coverage, and it submitted to ITU and it was accepted in ITU as one of the 5G technologies. It's a very minor thing for India, but enter into standard body for the first time. So these are the timelines. I'll not go into slides, I have already given. So now what has happened is there was a lot of hue and cry. Operators were saying that how they can deploy two kind of network. So finally, what has happened that 3GPP has agreed to merge 5GI into the global standard, and that's a very, very good sign, and everybody is happy. And by June, that will be incorporated. Decision is already taken. By June, it will become part of the 3GPP specification. So this is all I had. I still have 5 minutes. If you have any question, I'll be able to answer.
Sir, do we have any 5G simulation software, something like DNS or packet tracer, so that we can see how by using different frequencies or by using different bandwidth modulations, can we just check out like how the planning can be done, how the design can be done?
Yeah, so all those emulators are already available in the market. For example, I'll tell you that government has funded, DOT has funded ITI and other IIT and other institutes. They have given 210 crores of rupees and they have created a 5G test bed completely indigenous. So they have also developed emulators for core, for radio and all. In addition, the commercial companies like Keysight and all, so they also have simulators for different network functions, and there are smaller companies in India who have actually developed. So it's already available in the market on commercial basis, or even at IIT Madras they have developed. So IIT Madras, since government has funded, one can actually easily get those emulators and simulators. And there are certain private players also who have developed.
IIT Chennai's emulators are available online free, sir? Are there to be?
Online, you have to reach out to them. They have a policy how they will be sharing their
resources
they have developed. So there is a process involved. So you have to apply for and there's a very, very nominal token fee as they give it.
Okay. And sir, regarding the resources, whether the current resource, the 3GPP documentation is the only resource, or is there any other resource documents are there?
3GPP is the best resource as far as specifications are concerned, right? And if you want to read something extra, then all these OEMs, be it Nokia, Ericsson, or Qualcomm, they release white paper on each and every aspect, even the tools and tester manufacturers. And there are a lot many webinars which are being organized by these Nokia, Ericsson, Qualcomm, which are available in public domain. You can just search and use that. So suppose you want to understand something, some topic, you can actually search and it will be available either in form of a white paper or a recorded kind of a webinar. I have also recorded all my sessions and those are available in a public domain on the YouTube. There are almost 80 hours of training on 5G, which is there on YouTube channel. So you can just search by my name, or I have given this link.
We have seen, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. So,
dear participant, if you have any question, please ask.
Sir, we are using OFDMA. Whether we are using any other multiple access technologies, sir, in the 5G?
So you are right. So I mean, whatever we are using in 4G, that is orthogonal frequency division multiplexing or multiple access, same we are using in 5G. The only difference in 5G is that in 4G, the subcarrier spacing, in OFDMA, you divide your channel bandwidth into number of subcarriers. So in 4G, it is 15 kilohertz. In 5G, it is very, very flexible and variable. You use 15 kilohertz, 30 kilohertz, 60 kilohertz, 120 kilohertz, and 240 kilohertz. The subcarrier spacings are based on which frequency band you are using, which use case you are trying to deploy. Accordingly, you get figured onto the network.
For uplink, sir? So whether
for
we uplink, are using SCFDMA or other things?
No. So in 5G, up till now, the same normal OFDMA, what was there in the downlink, for example, in 4G, we used to use a single carrier OFDMA in 4G. But in 5G, it is same, both thing, I mean, downlink and uplink, we are using same normal OFDMA.
Up to any other question? Any other question?
Sir, in 5G, up to vast distance, if LOS is okay, up to vast distance, we get proper speed, sir, 20G.
So, so just look at, so as I am saying that 5G caters to all kind of use cases. For example, if use cases is IoT, right? So where data requirement is very, very less, but coverage requirement is very high, latency requirement is also less. So for that, lower side of the frequency band, 700 megahertz would be deployed and will have that use case taken care of. Now for speed, urban area where enhanced mobile broadband is the requirement. So we'll be doing mid-band, maybe 3.5 gigahertz. So whose coverage would be, say, 1 kilometer, 2 kilometer. And as I said, I told you that onto the edge, if you go to the edge, you'll get 100 Mbps. If you come to the near, even you can get, if you are alone in the network, you can get 20 Gbps. That also depend upon how much spectrum I have deployed. For example, if an operator is given 100 megahertz of the band, so maximum speed which he can achieve is 3 Gbps. It cannot go to 20 Gbps, right? So depending upon how many users are there, how near you are, so your speed will vary. Similarly, for very, very high speed or hotspot, you can deploy millimeter wave. So millimeter wave side spectrum is huge, availability is there. So even DOT can give 1 gigahertz of the channel bandwidth in millimeter wave because available, right? So yes, there you can get even 20 Gbps of the speed. That is a hotspot environment. So what is a hotspot environment? Suppose we are in a conference room, all of us are sitting in a conference room, and inside you have deployed one or two small cell, right? So you can get 20 Gbps of the speed. Or at your home, suppose in your home, operator has taken fiber and deployed a home BTS for you, just like your Wi-Fi. So you can get very, very high speed in your office, right? So depending upon the use case, you will get the speed, and also it will depend upon the what resources an operator has deployed.
Okay. So for this, we get a more bit number of BTS to cover a city or national highway. We have to install more BTS.
Yes. So only for the coverage. Suppose only the coverage is a requirement. Speed is not requirement. So just like your 2G BTSs, you can deploy 900 megahertz, 700 megahertz. So you'll have some kind of umbrella coverage, smooth all over. But wherever there is a data requirement, you have to deploy mid band. Wherever there is a very, very high data requirement, you have to deploy millimeter wave. So it is all use case based, right? So urban area, if you see, there will be a huge number of every 20 meter, there will be a base station. But size will be very, very small, just like your Wi-Fi dabba, this 5G small cell will be.
So 3G and 5G coexistence, as you told, 4G, 5G coexistence, 3G and 5G also coexistence.
Yeah, I mean, so normally 4G and 5G will coexist, and today we are not able to switch off 2G all because the devices in the rural area, gaon ke bandon ke paas 2G device hai. Agar aap aaj band kar denge to 20 crore connection band ho jayega. To hame majboori hai 2G chalana. So there are factors for coexistence, right? Suppose 3G is being switched off very fast because सबके पास 4G फोन है. अगर कोई स्मार्टफोन लेता है तो उसमें 4G कैपेबल है, लेकिन जिसके पास पहले से ही वो 2G फोन छोटा वाला है, इट डजंट हैव 3G चिप और 4G चिप, तो इसलिए हम बंद ही नहीं कर पा रहे हैं 2G. उसमें टाइम लग रहा है. पूरे वर्ल्ड वाइड यही प्रॉब्लम है कि 2G वाज मोस्ट सक्सेसफुल टेक्नोलॉजी, मोर नंबर ऑफ डिवाइसेज इन मार्केट, एंड वी आर नॉट एबल टू रिप्लेस फ्रॉम द डे वन. सो दैट्स व्हाई इट्स टेकिंग टाइम. उसी तरीके से 4G 5G बहुत दिनों तक कोएग्जिस्ट करेगा, क्योंकि 4G की डिवाइसेज इतनी ज्यादा मार्केट में है, यू कैन नॉट रिप्लेस और यू कैन नॉट आस्क एवरीवन टू रिप्लेस टुमारो ऑल द डिवाइसेज. दैट्स व्हाई इट विल कोएग्जिस्ट. ऑपरेटर हैज टू रन 4G एंड 5G नेटवर्क टुगेदर फॉर वेरी वेरी लॉन्ग पीरियड ऑफ टाइम.
सर व्हाट इज द टेंटेटिव कॉस्ट ऑफ 5G सर?
टेंटेटिव कॉस्ट ऑफ व्हाट? बेस स्टेशन और
हैंडसेट सर? हैंडसेट, मोबाइल सेट. मोबाइल सेट सर, 5G एनेबल्ड मोबाइल सेट.
डिवाइस तो उसी कॉस्ट में है. आज के दिन में 5000 का भी 5G फोन है, 10000 का भी है, 30000 का भी है. सो कॉस्ट इज सेम. बिकॉज व्हाई कॉस्ट इज सेम? आई शोन यू वन स्लाइड दैट द शिपमेंट ऑफ डिवाइसेस ऑफ 5G हैज ओवरटेकन शिपमेंट ऑफ डिवाइसेस ऑफ 4G. तो जब मास स्केल पे प्रोडक्शन होगा तो कॉस्ट तो वही हो जाएगा या कम हो जाएगा. सो इट्स ऑल इकोनॉमी ऑफ स्केल. The number of devices getting shipped in India or worldwide, 5G devices are more compared to 4G now. It has overtaken.
Okay.
So unlike in 2G and 3G, 5G will not be deployed in full scale. Definitely, it will be in phased manner, depending on the use case only. Maybe in the near future also, because we are hearing that in media, it will be launched somewhere in August, September in India. And can we expect investment, sir, or full scale?
So I'll give you two examples. One example, and then I'll talk about India. So I'll give you example of USA. USA, there are three operators. I'll talk about Verizon. So in 5G, there is a concept of dynamic spectrum sharing. So what do we mean by dynamic spectrum sharing? So whatever spectrum 4G is using, 4G is deployed on certain spectrum. So in US, they had 20 megahertz of 4G spectrum, and they were also using carrier aggregation in 4G. So they will have a multiple chunk of 20 megahertz. Yes. Somebody will have 60 megahertz. Somebody may also have up to 100 megahertz, right?
Yes.
So with dynamic spectrum sharing, what they are trying to do, they are deploying 5G along with the 4G. And on dynamic basis, spectrum is being shared. That means in every millisecond, network sees that how many 4G customers are wanting data, how many 5G customers are wanting data. Accordingly, those resources are allocated to 4G BTS and 5G BTS, right? So that is dynamic spectrum sharing, right?
So what Verizon has done, that they are covering almost 100% geography of US with 4G network. So they have enabled completely entire network with 5G along with 4G by a software upgrade, because whatever equipment has been supplied to us, to operators after 2015-16, all are software based and 5G can be upgraded with the software. So Verizon has upgraded entire network as dual 4G and 5G, and they are using kind of a dynamic spectrum sharing. So immediately they have covered the entire country with 5G coverage and also the 4G coverage. So that is one part. So they have an umbrella coverage on some kind of lower side of mid band. In addition, they have deployed the millimeter wave 40 gigahertz band in the hotspot area. They have targeted all the stadium in the US, all the dense urban area in the US, and they have deployed that particular spectrum. So they have a hotspot high speed coverage in the area where required, and they have an umbrella coverage of 5G along with the 4G across the whole globe using the dynamic spectrum sharing. So that was an kind of a use case or example of US. Similar is the example in other countries you can study. Now in India, since we had given them, all the operators given them spectrum in all the three bands, low band, mid band and millimeter wave for trial. So they have, and 13 cities we had given, 13 cities, for 13 cities they had asked for and we had given from DOT, and they have tested it. So that means they are already ready with 5G, and with availability of spectrum, they'll be able to launch initially in those 13 cities immediately, and then perhaps they will roll it out across the country slowly. So that is the status.
That means all the core networks are SDN based, because in 5G from release 15 all SDN.
Yeah, so all the 4G deployment today, even in our country, if you take Jio or if you take Airtel, those are software based, mostly software based. And if they talk to the same OEM like Nokia, Ericsson, they have a solution to upgrade to 5G, right? Of course, they will ask money, but they'll be able to upgrade. So, I mean, with some cost, operators will be able to upgrade their network to 5G very, very quickly.
It will be a great.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for wonderful delivery. So, dear participants, what is your experience regarding the lecture?
Thank you so much, sir, because the Ashok sir has given a very detailed explanation even for a small question also, by telling the detailed use case. Just now he talked about Razor use case. We haven't heard about it, about the umbrella and denser band coverage. Thank you so much for
yeah, arranging. And other than the technical aspect also, sir is wonderful human and very kind hearted, always ready to deliver the lecture, especially in case of AIITC. So from the folded hand, I need to say thank you very much, sir, on behalf of all the participants. Thank you. Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you
for Nitin. This wonderful delivery. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Nitin. May I leave now?
Yeah, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. So, dear participants, do you require the 2 or 3 minutes break, or next faculty can continue?
Break required, sir.
Break required. Okay. Very quickly, maximum 5 minutes.